Here comes Daredevil!
Hey, hornheads! Welcome to episode 1 of Here Comes Daredevil, the podcast dedicated to covering every issue of the Marvel comic title in order of release. We'll also be giving honourable mention to some of DD's appearances elsewhere and discussing some of the Daredevil miniseries as well. Here Comes Daredevil is an enhanced podcast, which means that images relating to the audio can be viewed on your iPod or computer. A standard MP3 audio only version will also be available. My name is Owen Challs. I will be your regular host on the show, but each week I will also be joined by a guest host or two or three. And this week I am joined by Mr. Matthew Petty.
Good evening, how are you?
And also Mr. Christopher Mead.
Hello, hornhead.
Can I get my hornhead out?
Yeah, go on.
It's out.
An image we could do without, I think. And on with the show. So the plan is to talk about every appearance of Daredevil that we can find. His first appearance, of course, was in Daredevil 1, entitled The Origin of Daredevil. This was somewhat unusual back in the day because most Marvel heroes got tested out first in another book. So Spider-Man was in Amazing Fantasy 15, Wolverine was in Hulk 180, Thor was in Journey into Mystery 83, all before they got their own titles. Now, originally I thought I'd discuss how it was that the character of Daredevil came about, how he was originally conceived and how his character was designed and so on. But then I realised all the information I had relating to that was from a Stan Lee interview. So rather than just me rehash what he said, let's hear from Stan the man himself about how the character of Daredevil came to be.
I had created quite a number of heroes before Daredevil. There was Peter Parker, Spider-Man, who had all sorts of personal problems. In fact, all of my characters had personal problems or hang-ups or handicaps of some sort. So my job was to keep creating superheroes, so when I had to do a new one, the first thing I thought of was, what kind of handicap can I give somebody? Now, I think I had already done the mighty Thor, the Thunder God. And in his human identity, he limped, he was lame, and used a cane. And all of them had something. Iron Man had a weak heart. I had very strange heroes. At any rate, it occurred to me, what if I had a hero who was blind? Because I had known a blind person who I marveled at his ability to function in many ways. And he seemed to hear better than most people, because his hearing had to be sensitive because he depended on it so much. And I thought, if I could get a blind man who developed his other senses to an extravagant degree, who had super senses, and show that he could function better than a sighted man, even though he was blind. And that idea fascinated me. I remember I thought, if his sense of touch was incredibly sensitive, he wouldn't need Braille, but he could run his finger over a newspaper and the ink itself, he could feel that. So he could read just by doing that, read a page faster than a sighted man could. And I felt he could even tell if you were lying, because his hearing would be so acute that he could hear if your heartbeat was speeding up and your pulse. Therefore, it was like having a built-in lie detector. And I began to think of all these qualities. You know, your sense of balance comes from your ear. A tightrope walker or someone like that, they use their balance from their ear. So if his hearing was so acute, he could do anything that a circus performer could do. He could be a trapeze star, a tightrope walker, and so forth. He could walk on telephone wires from the poles in the street. I began to think of all the scenes we could get. The more I thought about it, the more I loved this character. And I must say, I still do.
And so do we, Stan. So do we. So on to our front cover. We can see here comes Daredevil, the man without fear. And the comic only cost a mere 12 cents then back in the day. We've got a cover date of April. The year was 1964, but I'm going to guess that this was actually printed in late 1963 because, you know, the cover date is always closer towards the date that the magazine will actually be removed from the stands. And there we've got, remember when we introduced Spider-Man? Now we continue the mighty Marvel tradition with Daredevil. Can you guess why Daredevil is different from all other crime fighters? And then we've got a picture of Spider-Man, a worthy companion magazine to such all-time greats as the fabulous Fantastic Four. And there's the Fantastic Four themselves, and below that, the ensemble of cast members we are going to meet in the book.
I love the fact that Stan is so, you know, he's just gone straight in with the, like, remember me? I wrote Spider-Man. This is going to be great, isn't it? And the Fantastic Four. Go and read this new book, kids. It's a bit kind of blatant, isn't it?
Yeah.
I think what's really funny is his selling point for Daredevil is that he's the most unusual hero of all. Like that, not that he's the strongest or the fastest or the quickest, but the most unusual. Like, you know, does something weird. What can you think of? Something weird.
I think
unicycles to work. I don't know. But also, I think what's funny about the front cover for me is how he's described Karen Page as looking quite gorgeous. The gorgeous Karen Page. And if you look at her picture, she's not gorgeous, is she? Look at her.
And the other thing that's strange is fun-loving Foggy Nelson. I always thought that Foggy Nelson is, he's the kind of downtrodden comic relief, generally, I think.
I quite like the fact that none of them are looking at each other. And of course, for Matt, that's fine because he's blind. But you think the other two could make eye contact. But they're all looking in completely different directions.
They really hate each other, don't they?
Okay, so on to the splash page, which is page one.
Remember this cover? That was great. This is not so good.
It says, if you're one of the fortunate few who bought the first copy, you probably wouldn't part with it for anything. Now they actually congratulate you for having bought another prized first edition. This magazine is certain to be one of your most valued comic mag possessions in the months to come. How right you were. Edition. Not
anyone?
In the months, in the years to come. I think they're worth about $2,000 or something now, this comic, if you get it.
Really?
In mint condition. It's. I mean, you're going to pay at least £700, I think, for it.
Is the picture of Daredevil on that picture there the same one from the front cover?
Yes, it is. Yes. I mean, the reason that's unusual, but the reason for that is because Bill Everett, the guy that drew this issue, handed his pencil drawings in extremely late, costing Marvel thousands of dollars, which is a lot in the 60s, and they had to kind of cobble it all together. So the drawing on the front cover is actually a concept drawing by Jack Kirby. Yeah.
Mm. Right.
And then they've just made a splash page from that. But to be honest with you,
it looks okay. It looks good. Yeah. But it's just they've angled it a little bit different and they've inked it a little bit different. And but it's the same. It's the same picture.
Yeah. I mean, it might be worth mentioning, I've done a little bit of research on Bill Everett. His name is actually William Blake Everett because he's a descendant of William Blake, the poet.
Okay.
And he'd worked for Marvel's predecessors, which were Timely and Atlas, and he was he was the creator of Namor the Submariner.
Rubbish character.
I don't know. He's pretty well regarded. He's still going. Everyone loves him, apart from Chris.
No, I hate him.
Really?
Him and Aquaman.
They're the same, really, aren't they?
Yeah, yeah, they are the same. Yeah.
I mean, because Daredevil, and like most Marvel characters, there was another character in the 30s called Daredevil, and he had this like half blue, half red costume, and he threw a boomerang.
Was the first Daredevil blind?
No, but I think he had some like
learning difficulties,
bad throat surgery or something.
All right, that's not really a power, is it?
He might have. I mean, he might have been mute or something. I can't remember, but something.
He walked,
again,
not
really a power.
Did he walk with a bit of a limp?
He had some sort of disability. I think.
He had no legs.
I don't know. Maybe
he couldn't. He couldn't hear.
But
One-handed.
At the time of Daredevil,
had a brass hand.
At the brass hand. At the time of Daredevil, he was working as an art director at a paper plant. And,
what Daredevil was?
No. William Blake Everett.
Did he have a brass hand?
No. But apparently, he was on the phone talking to Stan at some point, and Stan had this idea for Daredevil, and they discussed it, and Bill wanted to work on a new character. So while he was still working at this paper plant as an art director, he came on board to draw Daredevil. But, yeah, basically, he couldn't handle, because he was working something like 14 or 15 hours a day at this plant, and then he would come home and try to do the comics at night, and he was unable to make the deadlines.
pencils got turned in really late, cost Marvel thousands of dollars. They had to get, I don't know if you heard of, there's an artist called Saul Brodsky, another guy you probably have heard of called Steve Ditko, and they had to ink all the backgrounds and sort of add all the secondary figures and stuff because it wasn't really finished, and that's why they had to cobble together these pages because, you know, they were desperate to get this thing out.
Was the guy's artwork any good when he could do it?
I think so. I mean, I don't want to take away from Bill Everett because he is credited as being the co-creator of Daredevil in terms of visually how he looks, and no doubt, I don't know if you're aware of the Marvel method of writing, but basically Stan would come up with a really vague plot. He wouldn't like write a script, a panel by panel script like you would get nowadays. He would just kind of tell you the outline, and then the artist would draw it according to what Stan had said. So the artist would pretty much come up with a story in terms of, you know, how it appears on the page, and then Stan would just put in all the word bubbles and dialogue and stuff like that. So a lot of the time there's miscommunication between the artist and the writer. But yeah, basically it's unclear really how much sort of input like Jack Kirby had into the character. Bill Everett did say that he asked him for help and that Kirby had come up with the idea for the Billy Club. So who knows? But one thing I will add is that Bill Everett was a teenage alcoholic. And Jack Kirby's assistant has said since then that at this time, Everett was suffering from what we now politely term alcohol-related issues. So that might have had something to do with it, but it couldn't have been all that bad because eventually Stan had Everett come back to work on Marvel, and he worked on the Hulk and eventually went back to the Submariner as well.
Can I ask, do other people use that kind of Stan Lee Marvel method? Because I've been reading up, concurrent with reading this episode, I've been reading the Man Without Fear miniseries, and there's an introduction to that where Frank basically says that they came up with a plot, then the other guy drew the entire thing, and then he wrote the script, which seems so weird to me. Yeah.
When you look at the ending to some of the later Daredevil, the finishes to the villains, how they're defeated doesn't seem to make any sense when you look at what's happening. He does something and then suddenly they're defeated and it doesn't make any sense how it got there. Like the picture doesn't match up to what the narrator or the characters themselves are doing or saying. It's all just a little bit strange.
Yeah, that's probably the reason why, because they, you know, I don't think they'd have much conversation after. You know, Stan, I don't think Stan would go back and say, like, oh, what was it in this panel? What did you mean there? He just would make it work somehow. Because he was writing, I couldn't tell you how many, but a ridiculous amount of comics each month.
How many people did they have on the staff for this?
Well, they only had two full-time members of staff. So that was Stan Lee and they had a secretary, Flo. And they were the only full-time staff. Everyone else was freelance.
It just seems so crazy to have an artist write the whole thing in just a visual style. Yeah. And then you write. I mean, I know the plots worked out. It seems like a crazy way of working. I think sometimes the pacing isn't quite right in some of these. And I think that must be why, because the artist and the writer want to tell the story at a different pace slightly. And when that happens, it feels a bit jarring.
Yeah. At the time, it was out of necessity because, like I say, Stan Lee was writing everything. Pretty much.
Yeah.
And that he only had time to say, oh, well, basically this is what happens.
Did you, as well as that, you say the artist would draw the story and then they write the script. Did they get a look at it before they write the script, or did the artist just describe to them roughly what happens? Did they get a look at the pictures? Did they get a look at the storyboard?
Oh, yeah. I mean, what would happen is Stan Lee would say, right, this is the basic plot. So he might give them... He might just talk to them over the phone, or we'd give them like maybe one page of typewritten plot. And then they would go off and they would make the story spread out over 22 pages. And they could add things or, you know, whatever. And I think a lot of the time they would end up doing things that Stan Lee didn't actually want in there. But it was tough because, you know, he didn't have time to change it.
Would they draw the speech bubbles?
No.
How would that work?
It would just be the artwork, and then they would add in all the speech bubbles and sound effects and dialogue and stuff like that afterwards.
How would you add in an age before digital production?
I don't know, to be honest. I think they just drew over the top. I mean, I'm pretty sure that they, you know, the artists wouldn't put anything in like that. So, because the letterers would come in and do, you know, obviously the dialogue and all the sound effects and things like that. So, like, in this book, it's Sam Rosen who does all the lettering, although I think it's actually Artie Simek on the cover because it's different. Sorry, on the splash page. So, we open on Fogwell's gym, and there's a few kind of hoodlums sat around playing poker, I imagine.
Tiddlywinks.
It could be Tiddlywinks.
There's a naked man.
Well, I think the idea is probably just come out of the showers or something.
Maybe they're playing strip poker and he's losing.
That's a good point. So they're all talking about this guy, the fixer, who they obviously work for. And suddenly, someone burst into the room. So basically, they're all very surprised to see Daredevil standing before them. There's one guy who says, "I've seen nutty get-ups, but that one takes the cake," who looks like a turtle or tortoise that's lost its shell.
He also says it in yellow for some reason.
See, in my version, because I'm reading from the Masterworks edition, it's just a white, it's a recolored.
No, it's yellow in the version I've got.
Yeah.
What's really strange is, for some reason, the guy in the nearest gangster to the front of the comic book, as it were, is taking a lot of money out of his wallet for no reason.
I think he might be putting it in because he's just either stealing it off the table or he's won it.
When the panel above is making his magic coins dance, and and then below that he's taking money. This guy just messes about with money all the time.
That's his thing. All gangsters have a thing. Some of them look like turtles. Some of them, you know, have weird broken noses and ears. And some of them, yeah, have magic dancing coins.
And some of them have undone green shirts and sort of thrust their groin out a lot.
the one who's putting his cash back in the wallet, he totally looks like he speaks like, "You're in the wrong place, she."
Look at him. Just look how near that hat is to his head, to his face.
At least they compliment him. They're like, "But look at his build. Hang around, fella. Maybe the fixer can use you."
That is a weird thing to say. Someone comes in dressed as sort of a freaky circus acrobat, and you're like, "You've got a nice build." I mean, that's what how gangsters talk, isn't it?
"He looks a bit tasty."
And I don't mean with his fists. Yeah.
So now, see this bit here. They then instruct Porky, who's the sort of half-naked guy, to go and attack him. So first of all, his nickname is Porky. And then he says, "It'll be a pleasure, boys. I can use the exercise." How low is his self-esteem at this point?
He has got a big belly.
Yeah. And then Daredevil compounds it by saying, "If it's exercise you want, fatso, you've come to the right guy."
Now, what's interesting as well is when you follow the what he's doing there, he am I reading this wrong? Does he go from like having his feet in his stomach to be swinging him round by his legs?
He does.
That's pretty impressive.
See, then we've got the first use of the billy club there, where he knocks the gun out of the guy's hand. One of the things that's been said about Daredevil is that he's kind of a poor man's Spider-Man.
Yeah.
In that, you know, because he's making these kind of wisecracks here, which is something Spider-Man does. Considering that he's there to avenge the death of his father, you know,
it's
I would
pretty
think
happy.
That he's pretty, he would be quite on edge and hyped up, you know, but he's just having a laugh.
If I was avenging my father's death, I think I would be shaking with rage at this point.
Yeah.
You know, and he just chokes his way through it.
He's quippy. I mean, sometimes people get quippy. If we're still going a bit further on in the fight, I don't know if we can. On page four, I really like the guy who says, "I'll take care of that crumb my way." And his way is throwing a chair at him. I'm just wondering if that's like, he's known for it. If his name's like Donnie the Chair Falco or something.
Yeah, I love that. I've never ever heard that crumb as a kind of that crumb. Maybe because they're not allowed to say bum because of the comics code.
It's just the way Donnie rolls, I reckon. Yeah. And if you look at it in the wrong way, he will throw.
He will throw a chair at you.
He's just got a selection of chairs all the time.
I think very aptly he grabs one. What are those things called? The kind of lariat things he's got. They're almost like gymnastic.
Oh, gym rings, whatever.
Gym rings, yeah. He grabs one of those and like kicks three people in the face.
With sufficient force to turn them completely upside down.
But I think that's a real, that's at this time, that's the epitome of what Daredevil is. Like the sort of gymnast acrobat type. I think that's his thing.
But if you think about the physics of it, if he jumps up vertically in the air to grab some gym rings, he then needs to get the forward momentum to circle around and kick everyone. Well, in real life, he would just sort of limply hang there.
If you look in the panel where he's, where they're like saying, get him, this, you can see the ring over the head. So maybe he jumped over them like that, grabbed the ring, turned, flipped around, and then that's why Harry smashed them in the head. I love, and when he's kind of beat them all, what I love there is that at the top, Porky's going, it ain't possible. Nobody can fight like that. He must do it with mirrors.
What's really, I don't know if I'm on a different page here, but you know when he's tackling the guy and it looks like his spine's coming too?
Yeah.
Look at the expression on his face. He looks like he's been mildly surprised, not mortally wounded.
Yeah.
Look at his...
He says, oof.
Oof.
And then he says, now that playtime's over, I'll hang around until I find the fixer. As for who I am, you can just call me Daredevil.
That is brilliant. What? I love the fact that he's decked them all and then they all sort of stand around in some silence. Like, what do we do now? Oh, I'm just going to wait for the fixer. They just all sort of quietly just sit there and wait for him. It's like awkward.
Look, Porky's a right fat bastard. Look at his belly there whilst he's mopping his head with a cold towel or whatever he's doing to make himself feel better.
We get a bit more of Stan Lee's bombast here. After he says, just call me Daredevil. There's a little panel that says, Daredevil, a brand new name in the world of superheroes, but one which is destined to reach the very heights of glory. For Daredevil has a special type of power, such as no adventurer has ever had before. To learn what it is, let us go back a few years, back to the origin of the man called Daredevil.
Do you think that Stan Lee sat around somewhere looking into a crystal ball, looking into the future, as he tells you all this?
Yeah, I mean, man was right, but I assume for every one of these comics, there's one where Stan Lee's sort of going, and now the incredible Bullet Ears, which will go on to be a brilliant comic that will sell millions. He just probably just said it for everything he wrote.
So, the year is 1950. As the prize fighter known as Battling Murdoch talks to his 8-year-old son, Matthew. See, now I think that's interesting because they don't tend to date things in comics anymore because, you know, it's all very timeless and could, you know, because you might be reading it 47 years after it was printed. This has got me thinking because if the year's 1950 and Matt Murdoch is 8, that means that in the current time of the comic being printed, Matt is 22. Okay, so we're shortly going to discover that Matt Murdock is a lawyer. He's got his own practice in partnership with Foggy Nelson.
Yeah.
So if he's 22 in the present day of the story, that doesn't make any sense because in the United States, and I've done a little bit of research on this because that's how sad I am, you have to do a 4-year undergraduate degree before you can qualify to take 3 years of law school. So if he started his undergraduate degree when he was 18, he'd be 26 before he even graduated.
Right.
But
you've got Stan Lee there.
I have.
I wouldn't like to be Stan Lee right now. Well,
but, you've ruined it. You've just ruined it for everybody.
As the comic's been running for 47 years, that means Daredevil is 69 years old.
He looks good for his age. I'll give him that. He doesn't. He does look good.
But a lot of people have said that Marvel's got a compressed timeline, so only about 10 to 15 years have passed since, like, the Fantastic Four got their powers.
So, like, Spider-Man's grown up, hasn't he? Because when he started, he was just a kid at school, wasn't he?
But he's only about, I think he's only ever gotten to be probably mid-20s before.
Doesn't Marvel ever periodically restart their timeline?
No, but they, like Spider-Man, they've rebooted him loads of times because he got married at one point and now he's
rebooted him in the ass.
Yeah. Joe Quesada ruined it. but
Straczynski was good.
Daredevil's never really been sort of reset at any point, although it doesn't really make sense as one continuous story now.
There's an ultimate Daredevil, isn't there?
Yeah.
And that's the different storyline.
Yeah, but in that, it's like they didn't think that Daredevil was, you know, deserved his own title, so it's actually Ultimate Daredevil and Elektra.
All right, okay, fair enough.
But it's more or less, I mean, the Ultimate Daredevil was more or less the Frank Miller story of how he met Elektra.
Okay.
I don't know. I guess it's probably a bit pretentious, but I kind of think that superheroes, when they're done well, they sort of feed into that kind of archetype of myth and hero. And you don't sort of... Hercules doesn't get, you know, a timeline which makes sense. I just think they are a way of telling a story. They don't really need... You don't need to worry about stuff like that so much. They're just... They're creatures of myth and archetype, and they're
nobody worries about like Jim. Nobody worries about James Bond getting older. He should be well old by now.
No, I think it's also, it just helps with profit. You know, like, who wants to see a sort of 70-year-old hero knocking about?
Me,
I'd pay good money for that.
I think that's one of the things that is the charm of Marvel, though, because they have let their heroes develop and move on until Joker saw the. Ruined it.
what did he do? Sorry.
It was just like with Peter Parker and stuff, he'd kind of married to Mary Jane and all this sort of stuff, and basically he just went, nah, let's make him a teenager again. I really love one of the images in this comic that's my favourite, is the one of where he says, "I promised your mother before she died." That one. It's a really famous line that's been used over and over again when he says, you know, that I wouldn't let you grow up to be an uneducated pug like me, because that's used in every sort of origin story you ever see, and that was used in the movie as well.
Oh, really?
Yeah. But that, I just think that just the artwork of that is amazing.
I like the fact that Matt Murdock is dressed as the Sandman.
Yeah, he is, actually, isn't he?
He is, yeah.
He's going out for Halloween.
But basically, Matt wants to go out and play.
Yeah. He's going outside with a baseball bat. And, he wants to go and beat somebody up.
No, he says, why can't I go out and play ball with the other kids? I can study later.
Oh, right, fair enough.
And basically, he, you know, like his father says, is he doesn't want him to turn out like him. He wants him to be a doctor or a lawyer or something like that.
On the next page, it seems like a nasty gang of circus enthusiasts just camp outside his bedroom window to taunt him the whole time.
I love what he says, though. He goes... The kids are Indian wrestling. If only I could go down and join them. Yeah, because they'd welcome you with open arms, like the little
especially because it seems in the next panel that he is dressed as a inmate in Guantanamo Bay for this next bit.
Don't you think he looks a bit like James Dean?
He does. He does a bit,
and a bit like the early Hulk in that panel as well. Yeah, but basically, you know, he can't go against his dad's wishes, and he makes the sacrifices and just carries on. But the kids outside, they mock him, saying, well, if it ain't old Daredevil himself. Oh, bit of foreshadowing there.
Yeah, really subtle, wonderful foreshadowing.
What is going on with that guy in the purple shirt's face?
See, in mine, it's a blue shirt with a brown hat.
He's wearing like a purple shirt and a green hat in my one, and his cheek is stuck out 3 inches beyond the edge of his face.
They actually both look like twins.
I think they both look like conjoined twins if you look at it carefully.
That's it. It's the circuses in town.
Indian wrestling outside his house. So Indian wrestling.
I have to say that they've used this in a lot of sort of iterations of Daredevil's like origin story. And I've always thought it's bullshit that, like, first of all, that kids would have the wit to be that ironic about it.
It's an ironic nickname.
Yeah.
If you were inside, you wouldn't be jealous about not being allowed to play with these freaks outside your house, would you?
I mean, like, hands down, I'd call him Ginger Ninja.
That's brilliant, yeah. No one ever calls him Ginger Ninja, but that is totally what he is.
He is, yeah.
Not back then, but now.
I like on the next page the bit where he starts training, and it's kind of... It tells you different kind of gym things. The barbells, the rope skip, the cable pull, the bike, the rowing machine. It's brilliant.
It's a really nice panel, I think. But and it says, it is only natural that the son of Battling Murloc should take to vigorous training the way a duck takes to water.
In tiny pants.
I was going to say, because you've both been known to frequent the gym.
Yeah.
Is that the kind of... stuff that you're training?
I always dress like that, to be honest with you, in the gym. To be honest with you, the bike, somebody needs to tell him that they've stolen most of the bike. There's nothing there, is there? They've nicked it.
That's it. It's Bill Everett again. He's probably pissed. Like, that'll do. Whatever.
Oh, fine. Look. Sorry.
And with the bag, he has thrust his head into the bag as well to achieve maximum damage.
The bag is smacking him in the balls.
He's got like, it looks like black football socks with white tops and just a pair of really tight black pants. Like,
somebody's stolen the rowing machine as well. There's nothing there. There's nothing there. It's a seat on the floor.
It's a roller skate on a piece of wood.
Did you say that this artist also created Namor?
Yeah.
So he just likes...
He just likes men in little in pants.
Little pants, yeah.
So then Matt's there studying. His dad comes in, so he quickly puts his clothes back on. They have a little heart-to-heart. But then things weigh heavy on old Jack Murdoch.
Yeah, he takes it out on a can.
Is Jack Murdoch moonlighting as a gigolo?
What, because of his...
Look at his suit that he's wearing and stuff, and you know, he looks a bit like a gigolo, doesn't he? Or an international man of mystery, or the guy that used to deliver the chocolates. I've forgotten his name.
Deliver the chocolates?
Yeah, the guy used to dive off waterfalls and things.
Oh, right.
Milk Train Man.
Yeah, the Milk Train Man.
Yeah, I think he's got a box of Milk Train that's a briefcase.
Really loves the Milk Train, that guy.
In the next panel, the final panel of this page, that says, finally, in desperation, Murdoch makes a fatal decision. I'm like, okay, so it's fatal. Good. That's so. Yeah. I'm glad we know where to depart.
Yeah, all right. So the fixer comes in and sort of says, you know, I'll give you some points. And you won't have to take a dive either, just because I'm already self-handed fall. That's how the fixer says. Here, sign the contract.
As the fixer got special needs as well, I don't understand.
I'm also loving the way Stan Lee has gone into metaphor. With trembling fingers, the middle-aged fighter grasps the pen as a drowning man would clutch at a straw, presumably to drink the water to stop himself being drowned.
Drowned.
I'm going to have to say, I think that's actually simile. But...
Oh, yeah, good point. Like is a simile. Simile, simile-like. Okay.
He rushes home to tell Matt the news, but Matt isn't there.
Where is he?
Well, as fate would have it, Matthew Murdoch, at that very moment, is returning from the library, taking the most important few steps of his entire life. Gee, you'd think someone would help that blind man across the street. See, because he's younger. That's why I'm doing that.
Yeah, I like what you've done there.
Say, mister, can I give you a hand? I love this. He didn't seem to hear me. He might be deaf, too.
What is this guy just walking along, just deaf and blind?
Yeah. Say, there's a truck turning the corner, coming toward him. This is in the days when Stan Lee had to put a speech bubble in every single panel and have the character narrate every single thing that they're doing.
Basically, as well, what's quite funny is the van that's driving towards him from Ajax Atomic Labs, radioactive materials, danger van. He's driving along on two wheels like that. It's got anti-gravity van. It's ridiculous. It is the most dangerous van in the city. And they've loaded it up with radioactive material for a laugh.
So, unfortunately, the van can't stop. And without a moment's hesitation, his supple muscles responding to the emergency with the speed of thought, Matt Murdoch hurtles toward the scene of impending disaster. He won't have a chance unless I reach him in time. And so he just, again, just this guy, this poor blind guy, who's just like tootling along, receives the crushing blow of the full weight of the teenage, you know, the fairly hefty Matt Murdoch crashing into his spine.
It's not even a tackle or a push. It's just like at the people's elbow, isn't it?
He just throws his back at the old man and sort of just breaks him in two like a wishbone.
Is it, to you, does it look like there's a panel missing here? There's like a panel missing? 1 minute is crippling innocent old men for a laugh, and the next news...
The cylinder fell from the truck. It struck his face. Is it something radioactive?
I think this explains all the really bizarre faces we've seen in this issue so far. All these people live in a town where radioactive substances are just ferried through the streets. They've all begun to mutate in various ways.
This is another example of this whole Spider-Man comparison, because it's yet again another radioactive sort of reason for a superhero getting his powers. But, you know, whatever, Stan.
As well. No wonder there's so many...
He was bitten by a radioactive blind man.
He could have been, like, when he fell, he was maybe like, you little shit! You broke my spine!
So he got Am I led to believe he got the proportionate speed and strength of a radioactive blind man? Yeah. Is that his powers?
Yeah. So then basically at the hospital, you know, Jack's...
Municipal hospital.
Yeah, Jack's pretty sad. If only it had happened to me instead of him. If only I had been there.
He wouldn't have been able to get there quick enough, though.
No. Don't, Dad. It could be worse. Even if I do lose my sight, at least I'm alive. See, I'm trying to make it like my voice is breaking.
Yeah.
Very good.
I like it. Look at the state of him in the hospital bed. He is covered from head to toe in bandages, right? And it says, and days later. And look at him. He's totally all right. His hair's grown back and everything. Look at him.
I don't know. He didn't go bald necessarily, though, did he?
He's covered in atomic material, he says, days later after the injured boy returns home. And look how happy he is.
Yeah, that's something I noticed about it. It really, he's okay with it almost instantly. I think Miller did a much better job in Man Without Fear of actually showing the turmoil of having your sight ripped away from you and having the scariness of having all these new senses. The Matt in this just takes to it all immediately and is doing somersaults and bouncing off his head and things.
I think it's supposed to reflect his demeanour, or more likely that they've only got 22 pages, so they have to kind of get on with it. But I don't think he realises, because he comes to realise his powers kind of a bit more slowly. It's not like it's not the kind of dramatic thing that you've seen in the movie, or like you say, the Frank Miller origin.
One panel is a pretty quick recovery, to be honest with you, but never mind.
So in the next page, he slipped back into his socks and pants.
And for some reason, he's fencing with a gym horse, for some reason.
Well, he's doing, you know, he's smacking the what's it called, the speed bag with his elbow while fencing.
The speed bag is basically his bitch all the way through. He's just taking out punishment.
And then, I'm not going to lie to you. In the panel next to that, he's doing the most unconvincing backflip I've ever seen. He is about to smash his head into the top of whatever it is he bounced off in the first place, isn't he?
Now, what he says here, right, as he's bouncing around, I wonder. And he says it out loud as well. You know, he's not thinking it, he's saying it. I wonder, could the radioactive elements which struck my eyes have anything to do with my increased powers? Whatever the explanation is, it's a supremely confident, self-assured Matt Murdock who finally graduates from high school and is eagerly accepted by the director of admissions of State College. The hugely generic State College.
They've really they've glossed over a lot of time has passed again, and they've just cut it out there, haven't they?
It's probably quite boring, though, stuff, isn't it, really?
Yeah.
The thing is, though, so he starts thinking that he wouldn't be surprised if it's the radiation that's helped him along, and even his studies are easier now. And then he says, my hearing is so acute that I can tell if someone is in a room with me just by hearing the heartbeat, and I never forget an odour once I smell it. I could recognise any girl by her perfume or any man by his hair tonic. Well, okay, back in the day, that's probably, you know, men did wear hair tonic. But I just think I recognise the girls by their smell is not something that they would want to hear. But this bit is the weirdest bit. Even my fingers have become incredibly sensitive. I can tell how many bullets are in the gun just by the weight of the barrel. What? What? Like, why is someone at law school... I mean, fair enough, he's from Hell's... Well, we don't know that yet, but he's from Hell's Kitchen in New York, so maybe he has handled a gun or two. He's had his fingers on someone's piece every now and again.
What would be quite funny is if they said, my hearing is so sensitive, I can tell how many bullets are in a gun by how many bangs it makes when they shoot it at me. That'd be quite...
And then he's like, well, my sense of taste has become so highly developed that I can tell exactly how many grains of salt are on a piece of pretzel. Well, I can do that because they're massive.
I don't really. I mean, I don't know where this is an appropriate point to bring this in, but Daredevil must be a rubbish lover, mustn't he? I mean, he must have premature ejaculation if he has that kind of sensitivity. There's no way, is there, that he could have any kind of sexual relationship?
Well, all his senses are heightened, aren't they? All his senses heightened. So,
Okay, so this is, I mean, that was just a general wondering, but this radar sense that he has that he goes on to talk about, I'm really confused by this. Is this something that different writers ignore sometimes? Because I've read different things. Certainly the Frank Miller one, it's just a combination of his other senses that allow him to move.
I always understood he had a radar sense that was separate to his other ones, like a sixth sense sort of thing.
Yeah, I mean, I mean, this isn't necessarily correct, or in fact, it's wrong according to this, but I always imagined it as it's like sonar. So even the tiniest sound, when he hears it, it translates into an image in his mind. So he can effectively see in 360 all the time. Okay. Unless it's completely silent, whereas if you're in a city, it's not going to be. But that's my own sort of interpretation of it. I don't think that's what they intended here, because it's like like literally radar. Like
he's, it actually says ping.
Well, it's as if
he pings.
It's like as if his brain is sort of sending out a signal and then receiving it back or something. Like a bat actually makes a high pitched noise though, whereas he isn't making. It'd be pretty weird if he's walking.
So
around
you're saying that he's using the sound around him. It, you know, you could get so much of like a size of a room, where things are. If you were acute with that kind of thing, you would.
So, the thing is, though, isn't his abilities and things like that, isn't it all down to creative license, and it depends on the writer?
They make it up as they go along, basically. It just
but don't you think there should be a consensus by now on what his power is? Is it something? Is it just the combination of the four? This sort of thing really annoys me. I really would like to have the parameters of powers.
I think they left it vague just to allow other writers. I mean, there's reached a point, I think, where a writer has probably gone, right, come on, let's nail this down. And then another writer's come along and said, nah, I'm not doing that. So
they've always described it as his radar sense, haven't they?
Yeah, but the trouble is that Stan Lee, you know, couldn't probably remember he'd written the month before.
Is that because he's too busy whoring himself out to every film that he's in?
No, that was before that. All right,
sorry, that's recently. Okay.
So we're saying that he has so much information from these other four heightened senses that he can pretty much, you know, he pretty much knows where everything is. Like,
yeah, but I mean,
he takes everything into account.
Yeah, it is saying, I mean, you can't quantify it because, well, you'll see as we read on through the issues, it's just random. They're quite often sort of say, by the sound of this, I can determine this. And I think, well, why are you relying on the sound? Why don't you just use your radar sense to determine it, you know?
It's whatever the story is again, isn't it? Yeah. The artist drew the story, the guys wrote it in afterwards, and they just filled in the gaps with radar sense, didn't they?
There's absolutely no mention of it in the Miller version. It's just literally, which I like much more. And I think in the film, which I know is not canon, he has to like smack a metal railing in order to create the sound.
Well, that's kind of along with my thinking of that. You know, that it's the sound that he hears that forms a mental picture. But I think if you read it here, it's not that at all. But
is this something we'll look into as this podcast goes on?
But so then you've got the next guy. There's a guy in a hat, of course, saying, "Say, son, want any help crossing the street? No, thanks, I can make it." Little does he suspect I can cross more safely than he can. For I have every one of my remaining senses working at absolute peak capacity.
Has he flicked the bonnet as it's gone past?
I think that's his the buttons of his fly coming off.
He just really loves that car.
So each of those pings in the previous panel, is that him sort of ejaculating at every point when he reaches that?
That's it, yeah.
He really likes walking in a funny line, doesn't he?
It was a toss-up between calling him Daredevil
and Erector.
Yeah. So meanwhile, the career of Jack Murdock is taking off, and he's winning all his fights. And Jack Murdock himself can't believe it.
And he's dressed even more like the milk tray man in that picture, isn't he?
He is.
Yeah, he's got a scuba diving suit on.
But then old Turtle heads back again and says, "Wait till the old fool finds out that all his fights were setups. You paid his opponents to take a dive."
Then, at which point I'd go, old fool, I really, really don't think that you can call him an old fool. You're about 90.
Yeah.
And then, for no reason whatsoever, there's a guy with a green hat in the background who does and says nothing. He's just stood there. Look at him.
He's just a mook.
He's a mook. You're a mook.
But then, that's right. So now we go back to Matt Murdock sort of walking the grounds of State College.
Trying to get away from Foggy Nelson.
Yeah. And
footsteps. I can tell by the weight, the distance between each. It's Foggy Nelson, and also the fact that he's yelling at me. His voice.
Exactly. He's going, "Hey, man, wait up! I want to read you the sports headline. It's about your dad."
And the fact that every footstep takes him 2 foot off the ground as well. Between, you know, look at him. He's flying.
So here's a little bit of interesting trivia for you now. See, you know it says there he's fighting Dynamite Davis tomorrow night. Dynamite Davis, apparently, is supposed to be the Absorbing Man.
Right.
Because I don't know what... If you read subsequent origin stories, like The Man Without Fear and Daredevil Yellow and stuff like that, he's actually fighting Creel, and that is the Absorbing Man's name. And apparently he had alias...
Right.
...of whatever, Davis.
So is the Absorbing Man the guy that can eat bullets and things and then turn his arm into a gun?
Well, he's like a...
It's Bushwhacker. I'm thinking of Bushwhacker. Sorry, I'm clicking a pen here.
The Absorbing Man is... I think he's mainly a Hulk villain. Oh, I could be wrong. But yeah, okay. He can just absorbs the properties of whatever he touches. I think he can take on powers of other people if he touches them.
Okay.
Is he the one with the ball and chain?
That's it, yeah.
He fights the Fantastic Four. He's fought the Thing before, hasn't he?
And Daredevil's dad whoops his ass.
He hasn't got his superpowers at this point, or is he just paid to take a dive?
Well, he has been paid to take a dive, hasn't he? We find that out. Spoilers.
No, I mean the guy that he's beating up, sorry, the Absorbing Man.
This one, Murdoch's supposed to be taking the dive.
Oh, right, I understand.
So, but he fights on... I mean, it could be that he wins the fight, though, because the other guy's expecting him to keel over at any moment.
Yeah,
so
yeah.
I wouldn't take that as a real triumphant sort of win. You know, Matt's there watching him, so his dad feels he has to go on and kick some ass. There's been different motivations behind why he does this. Because in Battling Jack Murdoch, which was a miniseries, he was going to take the dive because he feels that his son is obviously weak because he's blind, and that if he doesn't go along with it, his son's not going to survive without him. But in that story, which isn't sort of canon... Matt goes to the gym at night and for some reason wears a ski mask as well to practice. He just he trains because he's trying to study and he doesn't want his dad to know, much like in this story. So he just sneaks off at night to train at Fogwell's gym.
But
his dad happens to go there and meets a load of the Fixer's men who basically are going to beat the shit out of him to make sure that he does take the dive. And Matt intervenes and kicks their ass. But one of the guys, socks him in the face. And Jack, being a kind of, experienced boxer, is like, oh, you're going to have a black eye from that one, kid. Matt kind of runs off, but he leaves his Billy
schemer.
And then later on in the dressing room before the fight, when Battling Jack Murdoch's playing with it, he presses the catch on it and makes the cane sort of pop out. And even then, he doesn't get it. Do you know what I mean? He's surprised that this thing looks like it. He's like, it almost looks like a... And then...
Yeah, blind man's cane.
He doesn't say it. But then during the fight, when he's about to sort of, go down, he looks into the audience and someone knocks Matt's glasses off and he sees his son's black eye, and that's when he realises that he's a tough nut. And that's why he goes on, because he knows that Matt can look after himself. But... I don't really know what his plan is here. He's like, I'll make my son proud so that I can be killed and he'll live alone.
What is quite interesting is at the bottom of this page here, it says, nobody double-crosses the Fixer.
See?
You know what to do, Slade. And he says, yeah, boss, I know what to do. What would make me laugh a great deal is if in the next panel he was throwing a chair at him, like that guy from the...
I'd like it if all the Fixer's men threw different furniture. That was their thing collectively. Was that they all threw different bits of furniture?
Yeah. Danny the Stool Davis.
He has a lot of trouble with his bowels.
Yeah. Is he a stoolie? Is he a stool pigeon? No. He just throws stools at your head. What if there aren't any stools about?
It takes him 2 to 3 hours. He's got a lathe, little portable lathe. Makes it. It's beautiful craftsmanship.
So after the fight, for some reason, he's just won the qualifying fight to be in the heavyweight champion of the world match, and he's just on his own walking down a subway. Matt's not there. I suppose Matt's gone back off to college
to start identifying women by their smell.
There's no sort of women hanging off his arm. There's no press, there's no entourage or anything like that. It's just him on his own, and suddenly the sharp explosive sound of a gunshot destroys the silence of night, and ends one man's reverie forever. But we knew that because he made a fatal mistake earlier.
Yeah, absolutely. Was his fatal mistake that he took lots of drugs, like particularly crack, cocaine?
Is that what the crack?
Crack is, yeah.
Yes.
Gunshot. That's his last bit of crack.
Crack!
That's it.
So again, we don't even see a gun at all.
No.
Just have a crack panel.
What looks like a man with an erection in the panel hiding around the corner. He's got his hand in his pocket on a gun. It does look like a penis.
It does. And also, one of these two cops here, it comes back in about 130 issues as another character called Lieutenant Bert something. Later, after a grieving Mad Murdoch has heard the tragic news. So presumably like an hour later or something like that.
Yeah, he's got over it.
He's lying down on the bed, looks like he's been crying, his glasses are next to him, Foggy sat next to him there. Now, I presume that what we've been talking about earlier, the artist has gone, well, I'll put in a panel about grief, because we can just, Stan will just say something about, you know, he went through a period of grieving and then, like, carry on. But no, he's got Foggy saying, you gotta snap out of it, man. Pull yourself together, fella. That's what your dad would have wanted. Like, if that was me, I'd be like, fuck off.
I'll tell you what, Foggy, don't ever take up a grief counselling position at the university, Foggy. You're rubbish. You really
are. How long's it been? An hour?
And he says,
I want feeding.
He says, we'll be graduating soon, and my dad's sending me up in a law office. I want you to join me, Matt, as my partner. I'd be like, I don't give a shit about that.
That's just died.
Shut up about your bloody poxy law firm.
He is really, really proud when he shows him the door. He's got one hand on his hip. He's stuck his chest out proudly.
Well, that's the thing. See, now I'm going to have to get really geeky again now, right? But in the next panel, he graduates. And then the panel after that, it says, the next day in New York. And it's got Foggy going, we're in business, Matt. But now, I've already told you about the fact that, you know, you have to do 7 years of law school.
Yeah.
When you graduate, you can't just go and set up a law firm.
Really?
You've got to sit a bar exam,
right?
Which you take it, and then it takes a few months to get the result.
Mm.
I mean, you could say, because Matt is brilliant and he's such a good student, that Foggy's like relying on his knowledge to run the place. But you don't really become a lawyer after graduating. You kind of have to go, because in again, going back to Man Without Fear, which is the Frank Miller version, he's not at this weird state college. He's an undergraduate at Columbia. And then he goes on to get his law degree at Harvard. And then he works at a Boston law firm. And then he goes into partnership with Foggy. And that's pretty much considered to be canon now, because it's in the official Daredevil handbook.
Oh, right.
I'm not sure. I mean, they have hired Karen Page and her malformed breasts to help.
My name is Karen Page, Mr. Murdoch. I hope you'll be pleased with me. She's basically saying, take me now, isn't she?
Her voice is like music. From the sound, she's 5'4" or young. And I know she's lovely.
What is really, really seems quite unfair is how in the panel above, when he's trying to get his like diploma, and the guy knows he's blind, and he's deliberately holding it out of the way, and Max reaching forward with his other hand that he's not shaking his hand with, and the folks moved it out of the way so he can't get hold of it. And he's like, thank you. Cheers.
Also, it appears he's a victim of quite a cruel joke whereby probably the circus bullies, he said, is this a scarf? And it's actually like a skipping rope. Yeah, Matt, that's a scarf. Yeah, wear that. Yeah.
Can I join in with your Indian wrestling? No, put the scarf on. Can you get on my shoulders? No, my abnormally shaped face won't allow me to do that. Put this scarf on.
I think that is because he's valedictorian, so they put some sort of like old curtain ties around his neck to...
It's a cheap chick, really, on blind man.
Now, this next bit, when it says, later that night, in the furnished room, Matt has rented near the office. What a brilliant bit of detail that is that we need to know. The furnished room. So it's not an empty room.
Yeah, but it's unbelievable that he'd be able to, you know, buy a place nearby and furnish it in that amount of time. Right, okay. I mean, obviously, he's got his law degree in 3 years rather than seven and hasn't had to take a bar exam. But Stan's thinking about how would he get all that furniture so quickly. So he's taken that out of the equation.
Yeah, because otherwise there'd be like angry letters written in.
Dear Stan, I notice in the first issue of Daredevil that Matt Murdock has furniture straight away. How did he manage such a thing? Does he perhaps have super furniture procuring abilities that you haven't told us about? I don't think so, Stan.
So when he says that I'll never be able to concentrate, I was thinking he was about to say, I'll never be able to concentrate on my law work when I can't help thinking about Karen Page's malformed breasts.
They are pretty malformed.
But he actually says, you know, he needs to bring his dad's killer to justice. So he goes into a chest and pulls out some old shirts. So in the other versions, he makes a costume out of his dad's old boxing robe, which makes sense because, you know, it's honouring his dad, but also it explains why it's such a disgusting shade of yellow.
Yellow, yeah.
And, you know, it is really a costume that only a blind man would create, isn't it?
Yeah.
He's lucky that all of the colours... Oh, does it actually say somewhere that he can feel the different colours?
Well, he says, when he stitched me, he says, I'm no Betsy Ross. And I had to look that up. Do you know who Betsy Ross is?
No.
She makes cakes, doesn't she?
No, she created the first American flag.
Oh,
right. Did she make cakes as well?
No. I think that's Martha Stewart you're probably thinking of.
Oh, right.
He says, I can even blend the colours, which I think there's some truth in that, because I've heard that blind people can distinguish colours and with...
The material feels different. Yeah.
Well, I think it's the... Because they absorb... Different colours absorb light differently. So a blind person can feel the thermal energy deposited by light or something. But,
well, Daredevil can, because he's got extra
elevated
meds.
Senses. That would be no problem. And also, he wasn't born blind, so he would know what colours look like, even though that his costume is sort of contradicts
Clever.
That.
Clever. Clever.
But... Yeah, because all he'd have to do is, when he went blind, feel something and go, Dad, what colour is this? And then he'd learn what they feel like.
Because his dad was alive for quite some time after he went blind, according to this, wasn't he?
I would say it's about 7 years.
I like the little thing that he makes a costume, then thinks of the name, then has to redo the costume. I really like that.
Yeah,
I'm finished.
There's no D on his chest, is there?
And there's no horns on his head.
Oh, yeah, that's a good point. Now, I've always quite liked the Billy Club. I think it's quite a cool idea. But there's one thing here which I think is ridiculous, in that the top of it, which is curved, somehow straightens.
What does the hinge do?
It allows it to bend in the middle.
I don't know, because I think that in this, he seems to just have it as a stick all the time. But obviously, later on, it becomes more like two sticks or...
a grappling hook as well.
Yeah.
It says here, look, I'll hinge it in the middle, and then there's an arrow pointing to the middle of the stick and says, hinge, because you couldn't wear that out yourself.
Also, flexible handle.
That's what I mean, but what does that mean? How can you make a handle so that it's curved and then suddenly
flexible.
Straight? Flexible what? Wood? I can use it in 100 ways. It's perfect. Bong.
Way one, fishing.
I reckon he must have been poking on that bong to have created that costume. I mean, actually, I have to say that when I first saw, when I first became aware of this costume, I thought it was absolutely ridiculous.
Mm.
But I kind of like it now. I think
it looks better in the Daredevil yellow sort of graphic novel.
Yeah, just because it's got that modern, you know, it's kind of made to look a bit more acceptable with a darker yellow, maybe.
Yeah, it's more subtle, is the yellow, than this... monstrosity. He could beat up Green Lantern, though, couldn't he?
Because he's yellow. It does kind of look like an acrobat's uniform or something, doesn't it?
Yeah.
And now for the job at hand. I've got to bring my father's murderer to justice. Tomorrow, Saturday, the office will be closed. Or start in the morning. And he just thinks, Dad, because his dad's manager was the fixer, he thinks, oh, fixer? That sounds a bit dodge. I reckon we'll look into that. And I love that bit where the woman looks at him and goes, how confidently that blind young man walks through the street. And I kind of feel he doesn't need this cane anymore. And and to be fair, although he is genuinely blind, he's pretending to be, you know, more helpless than he is.
Yeah, yeah.
But he's rubbish at it, because all through the comics, people are always going, whoa, look at that blind man and how confident he's always doing it. He's rubbish.
What you need to realise as well is what would have been funny if she just said, look at that confident blind man. Oh, it must be that hinged walking cane with the flexible handle that allows him to do this.
He then finds the fixer's den, and that brings us back to the present where he's just busted in, which I think for a 60s comic is quite cool in terms of the actual chronology of how they've told the story. They've put the exciting bit first and then done a flashback and then gone back to the action, as it were. So the fixer then appears and says, you know, somebody asking for me. They basically upset each other and start a rumble, don't they, really? And when Daredevil mentions Battling Murdoch, he then says, you know, Battling Murdoch, what's that to you? It ain't healthy to mention him around here. And then you've got this thing where he says, the sound of a suit jacket being drawn aside, fingers touching a metal object, must be a gun butt.
How do you know it's fingers touching a metal object?
Because to him, the drawing of the fingers across the gun butt is like the screeching of a freight train down a track. Then he thinks to himself, the sound of his breathing, the telltale click of the pistol safety release are all I need to pinpoint my target. So he's completely using sound here to throw the billy club and knock the thing out of his hand, which is fine. But it's suggesting that his radar sense is literally a thing that goes, don't hit that cabinet, you know, or like there's a chair in front of you.
Probably is if he's fighting these henchmen. They love chairs, you know?
Yeah.
But the other thing is, he needn't have thrown that stick. He's near enough to that guy that he could just hit him with it anyway.
There's a guy who then tries to sneak up on him, and he says, no matter how softly he crept up behind me, his muffled footsteps sounded like heavy drum beats to me, and he catches him out. So remember that, because you can't sneak up on Daredevil.
No. So never. It certainly wouldn't happen in the same issue of the comic.
No.
So that's definitely not going to happen. Cool.
So basically, he kicks all their ass again. And what happens then?
Well, they calm down. Now let's all just settle down for a nice talk, unless you'd like another session with me. Is he trying to get them out on the sauce?
And then, yeah, they literally do just settle down. And I think this is brilliant, is that the fixer just says, call the cops, Sam. Which is kind of cool, because I don't think, you know, that... Why wouldn't you call the cops in that situation? But I find it interesting that they've put that into this story.
I think you wouldn't call the cops because you've just been accused of a murder by a guy, which you did actually do, and you're a gangster. I just think there's a lot of reasons why. I mean, okay, crazy circus guy has just broken into his office, but even so, there's probably quite a lot of incriminating evidence around, and if it was a crime scene, the police would have every right to look around.
What do you mean?
Hello, 999, hello, which emergency service do you require? Police, please, what's the nature of your emergency? It's a guy in a yellow suit throwing a stick around. It's got a flexible handle and a hinge in the middle. And, yeah, he's dressed in yellow and he's got a D on his chest. You know, they'd come, trust me.
But I don't know, I think because he's one of the typical gangs, you know, I'm a respectable businessman. Fixer, I suspect you were responsible for the death of Battling Murdoch. Why don't you confess now and save us all a lot of trouble?
He's doing a funny trick with his stick as he says this, isn't he?
I think what that is that he's thrown the stick to knock the receiver out of the guy's hand and then it's bounced back and he's caught it again.
Oh, right.
But that's obviously me just putting that together. There's no real indication of that.
No, there's no movement lines, is there?
No, it just looks like it's levitating there.
Basically, while Daredevil's kind of accusing him of being the murderer, and he says, you know, maybe you didn't pull the trigger, but you certainly, gave the order. Someone sneaks up behind him. It's Slade, actually.
I thought every footstep sounded like a drum beat.
Oh, yeah, good point.
Well, it looks like Slade is sort of falling towards him, so he's just planted his feet and he's just leaning, I think, so he's not using footsteps.
I don't get the impression that in the previous panel he's anywhere near a window, but...
I like the way the colour of the this room has got a thousand different coloured walls because it's blue, orange, pink, purple, and red. Different.
Yeah. In mine, which is probably different to yours. Yeah, it starts off like in the bit where he's it's pink, then it's kind of dark blue, then it's green with a kind of halo around Slade, then it's blue as he pushes him out of the window.
Yeah, oh, it's bonkers.
And then I love as he pushes him out the window. So intent. Oh, it does give you a little explanation. So intent is Daredevil upon listening to the fixer's pulse rate to determine if he is the guilty man that his ultra sharp hearing sense reacts a fraction of a second too slow. And
yeah.
Slade then decides to confess and says, "It was me! But you'll never be able to do anything about it," and pushes him out the window. A normal man with all his senses might be doomed in such a situation, but not Daredevil, because he hears flagpole rustling in the wind, and his lightning fast reflexes go into action. A flagpole alongside me. Only one chance. Pressing the hidden stud, which releases his cane handle, so now it's instantly going from straight to curved. As he lunges out, he stops his fall in midair.
Can we, as we're reading through these different comics, can we keep a tally of, it's got over 100 uses as this cane. Can we keep a tally of the different uses that he uses the cane for?
Well, he's already used it for two things, hasn't he, at least? He's thrown it at someone's head.
He's fought with it.
He's hung up a phone call with it.
He's fenced the gym horse.
Yes. He made himself look confident in the street with it.
Yeah. So what he does then is he swings around on the flagpole. I don't understand how he goes from that position back into the window, because he's completely vertical. And he somehow twists his... I mean, but it's Daredevil. He's an acrobatic genius. He twists his body up and through the open window. And now Slade has turned around.
Is his special power that Newtonian physics don't apply to him? It's the thing is, as well, he says, from here it's all a breeze. When he's in the most precarious situation you've ever seen in your life, he's upside down, swinging from a flagpole by a flexible-handled walking cane.
How's with a hinge in the middle. It's not even that safe, that cane.
It's hinged.
So then, while all this is going on, Foggy's wondering where Matt is, and he goes up to the office and sees that Karen's there on her day off cleaning up the office. And what I love is this bit of... bearing in mind that Stan Lee has always said that, you know, he's very much been one of the first people to kind of put women, to respect them and put them as fully developed, rounded characters in his stories, you know, and create the first female superheroes. So with that in mind, this little box panel here. But entering the new office, Foggy finds it unoccupied except for the most decorative accessory, Karen.
I know, Mr. Nelson, but I'm a stranger in New York and had nowhere to visit, so I thought I'd tidy up the office whilst I had a chance. Is Mr. Murdoch with you?
No. Matter of fact, I'd hoped he'd be here. I don't like him wandering around town alone.
I understand. What a pity such a wonderful, handsome man is so handicapped.
Wow, I'd sure like to hear her talk about me in that adoring tone of voice.
Dream on, Nelson. Yeah. You loser. There's something about him that makes a girl want to take him in her arms. And oh, I'm sorry, Mr. Nelson. I had no right to speak that way. It's just that he seems to need someone to look after him.
It would be hard to imagine Karen Page's feelings if she could see the handicapped man she's referring to at this moment. Oh, what's he doing then? He's just... going, out, all of you.
Get out! You as well, Turtlehead.
See, that's where you would expect there to be a picture of him, like, roundhousing someone in the face. But he's just standing with his back to the front of the panel saying, out, all of you!
What's really
and
funny
they definitely
is all
wouldn't just walk away and get a gun and come back and shoot him in the back of the head.
The thing is, though, it's all the villains from the very first bit of the magazine are all leaving, but they weren't there 2 seconds ago when he was knocking the shit out of them, you know?
And so, you know, he said, now, you two, I've learned what I wanted. Slade actually did the shooting, but you gave the order. What good will it do you? You can't prove it. Yeah, where's your evidence? So he thinks... Now for my final bluff. They're so worried now, they'll believe anything. Right here, I have a miniature tape recorder concealed in my billy club. It'll tell the police all they need to know. He's got us. That's bullshit, basically, isn't it?
What, the lie about the tape recorder? It is.
It wouldn't be that fantastical nowadays to have a miniature recording device in a billy club, would it?
The thing
pretty
is,
easy.
Is that, amazingly, not long after this, he does actually add... a miniature tape recorder to his billy club.
Always thinking.
So a bluff soon becomes a ridiculous reality. I just don't think in those days you would have been able to put a tape recorder in something that you throw at people's faces.
Also, yeah. You threw it at a bong earlier, didn't he? To be truthful. And it's hinged. So, you know.
So then...
Yeah, because you need a massive roll of tape, wouldn't you?
Yeah, but I mean, basically what's happened is the fixer has wrenched the rug out from under him. He's fallen over, wrenched his arm. they've got away, so he's chased them out into the crowd. But what he does is he then changes into Matt Murdock's clothes, which he conveniently stashed nearby, which is fair enough. He probably wore them there. Follows the cigar smoke and then sees them going into a subway. So what he does then is push past them.
Really quickly. Yeah, okay. Fast enough that they actually notice. You know, it's that odd that he's moving that quickly.
How did you see how fast that blind guy pushed past us?
Who cares? We got our own problems. So again, I'm thinking they've just been attacked by someone who was asking questions about battling Jack Murdock, right? They've now been pushed past by a blind guy.
And when Good morning, gentlemen. I'm not Daredevil. Bye.
But sure, I mean, I'm pretty sure they knew that, like, battling Jack had a blind son.
What's even more interesting is how quickly he gets in and out of his clothes. But also, what would have been funny is if he changed back into the Matt Murdock costume and still left the sort of balaclava bit of his costume on.
The cowl.
Yeah.
So what his plan is he pushes past them, goes really far forward, takes his clothes off, comes back, and stands there and goes, "Going somewhere, boys," in a kind of what to me looks like a very sort of sexually suggestive pose.
Separate! You can't get us both.
I was afraid they'd try that. I can tell by the unbroken sound of Slade's footsteps there's no one between us, so it's safe to throw my cane at his face. while he's tackling Slade, the Fixer escapes, and he trips up Slade.
It doesn't even hit him with it. It just goes in between.
It's pretty awesome. Pretty awesome shot. He then goes, "He's too far ahead. I need something to help me catch him." When would you say that?
This is a brilliant plan, this is. Balancing on top of this thing, this is going to be way faster than me being able to. I'm a super athletic guy. This is a fat old man who's about to have a heart attack. That's the level of fitness we're talking about. And he still doesn't think he'll be able to catch him up.
Do you know, if I was running down a subway station, I turned around and saw a guy in a yellow costume, like, fast-barreling it down the thing on the 50-gallon drum towards me, I think I'd have a heart attack as well, to be honest with you.
Seriously? It'd be funny if he steamrolled over him.
Look at the second the beefy, overweight, fear-filled figure of the Fixer grasps and slumps to the ground as his panic-stricken heart ceases to beat.
And I love the fact that two cops then arrive, see this masked vigilante who is crouching over the dead form of a gangster, and they were like, "Okay, bye, good, everything's fine here."
Yeah.
Do you think we should, you know, get this, maybe take this guy in and arrest him? No, it's fine. He probably had a heart attack by the look of him. It's fine.
Obviously, the Fixer's dead, but then he jumps on the passing train.
Yeah, doesn't lose his arm.
No, onto the back of Slade and thinks, "Now for my last bluff."
Bluff?
He's just such a brilliant bluffer, isn't he?
He just by getting on a train.
The Fixer just told us everything, Slade. He's innocent. You are Murdoch's murderer. And he falls for it. And he uses the well-often used phrase, "The dirty crumb." He's not going to wiggle out of this. He's as guilty as I am. I only pulled the trigger, but he gave the orders. Yeah, he's as guilty as you are. He said, "Go and kill him," and you actually killed him.
But somebody still got killed, and all he says to the police is, "Did you hear enough, boys?" And they're like, "Yeah, we did. Yeah, cheers." And that is it. Forget about it. Don't you worry about it.
See you later. Wait, who are you? "The name's Daredevil. Remember it. You'll be hearing it again. I promise."
I'll be killing lots of other old middle-aged gangsters soon enough.
Not long afterwards. "Matt, say, I was worried about you, fella. Where have you been?" "Just out for a walk, Foggy. I'd have been here sooner, but as you know, I can't get around that fast."
Every time we get out, I do walk around really fast to a point where total strangers comment on my ability to walk.
Blimey, that blind guy really is moving very quickly. Also, he's extremely confident and he's got hingeable stick.
I wonder if we've stumbled on the reason that Tommy played such a mean pinball.
Because he had a stick with a hinge?
Possibly.
Oh, just you wait, Matt. You're going to love it because that hinge comes into play very soon.
Does it?
Oh, yeah.
I'm loving the hinge.
So, back at the office, Karen...
Look how confidently that blind boy's playing pinball. I'm sorry. He really is quite mean at it, isn't he?
Back at the office, Karen says that they've just received a call. An accused murderer named Slade. So they received a call from a murder going, I'm accused of murdering Bad Lib Jack Murder. So he calls Murder for Nelson.
Are you related to Battling Jack Murdoch? No, I'm not. No, it's just a coincidence. Oh, right, okay. Yeah, bye.
Karen's got an interesting hair thing going on where she sort of stuck a bow. I don't know. I can't quite make out her hair, really.
I think her hair looks a little bit like a sphincter there, doesn't it?
Yeah. It looks like, if you just look at the hair, it looks like a kind of a hairy animal giving a shrug, kind of like, because the two bob bits look like hands.
Foggy has already turned him down because from the police report, he was convinced he was guilty. And asked Matt if he minds. And Matt says, no, I don't mind at all. Not a bit. Not one single bit. And for some reason, he's a blind man. He just turns his back and looks out the window over the city.
Matt, what are you doing? I'm just catching a breeze.
I'm sorry. I thought you were facing that direction.
And then he says, well, he thinks to himself, Dad, wherever you are, I kind of hope you're resting easy now. Why does he kind of hope? Like, whatever. If you're burning in hell,